Let's get started. Hey, and welcome everybody. Right now we are the only guys standing between you and lunch, and we started like 5 minutes late. Sorry about that. My name is Kent Agerlund, and with me on stage today I have special guest star Michael Niehaus, and I also have a few people under the podium preparing some Mac stuff for later. Right there. And the session name is What's New in Configuration Manager 2012 R2. And as some of you already know by now, hopefully, the date is October 18. I know that there were some operating systems released yesterday on MSDN, but Configuration Manager R2 is not among them, so we will still have to wait until October 18. My name is Kent Agerlund, and as you can hear from my accent, I'm not from Auckland. I'm not even from this part of the world. I'm from Denmark. And in many ways, Denmark is very similar to New Zealand. For instance, the weather is exactly the same right now. The only difference is that it's our summer and it's your winter. But I just checked it, and it's raining and it's 13 degrees, so I can't wait to get home. I'm a Config Manager MVP, or an Enterprise Client Management MVP. I've been working with Configuration Manager SMS since 97. And I've been working with R2 since we got our hands on the preview version, which is still the latest available version. And that's also the version that I'm going to demo on here. Michael, do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. If I have a microphone that actually works. My name's Mike Niehaus. I'm a senior product marketing manager. Told him, yeah, that's close enough. Worked for Microsoft doing Windows deployment, Windows manageability, and related stuff.
Yeah, and down under the table we have Peter Dahlmans, and I promise you that I will show him to the public later on when he's done with his Mac stuff here. A few things I was warned about, you guys not making a lot of noise during the session. But I truly hope that you do have a lot of questions, and I brought some speakers with me and some books with me and some other swag, so for good questions, primarily related to the products, please, there will be some swag. So the agenda, this is actually a two-part session, because R2 will introduce a lot of on-premise changes, and it will also introduce a lot of mobile device management changes. And the mobile device management session is actually tomorrow morning. And there we will, Peter and James will tell you all about working with Intune and how it integrates into Config Manager and stuff like that. And if that's for me, then I'm kind of busy. Some infrastructure changes, some of the feature changes in here, and then of course also the client support. When it comes to infrastructure changes, we do have a few changes. And the first one you will notice already when you start installing Configuration Manager. How many of you are already running 2012? That's a good half of you. And those of you who are running 2012, how many of you are running Service Pack 1? That's most of you. Okay, so the first and maybe one of the most important decisions you have to make when you're installing Config Manager, you actually have to make before you start the install, and that is how you're going to set up and configure your SQL Server. In SP1 and in the previous versions, it will just go ahead and install SQL and the database and log files in the default locations. Now in the setup, you'll be able to actually go in and say, I want my log files there and I want my database files there. If you have already pre-configured a database, and I usually do that because by pre-creating a database in Config Manager, I'm in complete control. So I can go in and pre-configure the number of files that I want, the size per file, and so on and so forth. Then the setup engine will honor that. So even though you see the choice in here, you can safely just click Next, and it will honor the settings that you have. No questions asked about that. For client mobility, how many of you are running multiple primary sites? Okay, I love this audience. I I truly love you guys, because running multiple primary sites should not be something that a lot of companies are doing. So only you were running. So we just have a single in here who is running that. So what you can do is, and now I'm just talking to you, a new feature in our tool actually allows you to reassign your clients between two. So this is not a backup solution or anything like that. Your two working sites actually has to be able to, they must be up and running. and the way you do that is basically you go in, create yourself a collection, figure out what devices you want to reassign, select your devices, and then you go in and reassign your devices. It's actually pretty straightforward. It will be a policy applied to the device, so we don't have to go in like in CMO7 and write a lot of custom scripts to do that. For those of you who are running a single site, if you want to reassign your clients to another site, I would not set up a hierarchy to do that. I would just set up a new CMO server, sorry, CM12 site, and then use the export feature. And as long as you're running the same version, you can always export your environment. Some of the reasons for using multiple primary sites, they have been greatly reduced with CM12. And I don't know about how many of you are running CMO7 right now? A few of you? And are you running, how many of you are running multiple primary sites there? Few of you? Okay. So in CMO7, it was very easy to run multiple sites, and it was absolutely okay. So if you had multiple environments, like a DMC environment, for instance, and a production environment, it was very, very common to have two separate primary sites. With CM12, it's actually not that common, because with secret replication, we need a two-way trust, and there's no way we want to have that between our DMC environment and our internal environment. So what are our choices there? You can basically set up a single primary site and then control your DMC client from that primary site. You can let your DMC clients control by the internet if you want to do that. And then if you want to set up a trust, or if you want to open up the correct ports, you can also set up a site system servers out there. I'm not talking about a primary site server, I'm just talking about a site system server. So the user-facing site servers, like a distribution point, a management point, software update point, and the app catalog point. There is one gotcha if you set up a distribution point. Because when I am a non-domain joint client, or if I come from a non-trusted domain, I will use the network access account to go log on to the distribution point and start my download. And in Service Pack 1, we could only have one network access account, but in R2, we can actually have multiple network access accounts. So if you want to have the scenario where you set up a distribution point server that is a member of another domain, then you can go in and specify a new network access account in here. Let me just go ahead and demonstrate. Can you I actually have people sitting under the table to switch between the different screens here. So that's the first one. So what I'm doing here is I just want to demonstrate a few things. First up, how many of you are familiar with PowerShell in Configuration Manager? It's like 3 or 4 or 5 of you. How many of you would like to become familiar with PowerShell in Config Manager? That's a good few of you. So the first thing that I use IC. When I use IC to run PowerShell commands, I need to import the Configuration Manager commandlet, and then I change the location to that. So the first two lines up here are like, you've got to have them every single time you run PowerShell from within IC, unless you open up or launch PowerShell from the Configuration Manager console. The next stuff I have here is I'm using the new CM device collection. So I'm basically just creating a collection in here, because what I want to do now is I want to reassign some of my clients that I have in the Auckland office. So let me just go ahead and run this. So it's creating a collection. And if I go into my assets and compliance, device collections here, I should see all computers in New Zealand. And I also did create a query. So I just basically said, it will give me all my my devices. And once I have my devices here, if those are the ones that I want to reassign, I can just go ahead and reassign the clients. Now you'll notice that mine is grayed out because just like you, I run a single primary site. It has support for 100,000 users, and I have not reached that count in my demo environment yet, so I see no reason for that. If you want to get started with PowerShell, a good colleague of mine, he actually wrote a little tool called the PowerShell browser. The PowerShell browser here is a great way to get familiar with all the commandlets in here. What you basically do is you import, or first let's browse for the Configuration Manager module. So the commandlet is Configuration Manager PSD1. It is installed when you install your administrator console, so it will be added in there. Then we just go ahead and import that, get the modules, and then it will list the modules in here. The great thing about this little utility, which is it's a freeware utility, so you can just go ahead and download it, it will list all the commandlets that you have in that specific module. So if I go, let's say, I just created a collection, the new CM device collection, then it will list the official help, but I can also cloud integrate this and then click download code example from CM. Should have some. I selected the wrong one. There you go. Here you go. So what it took, there is no example on this specific, and he's a bit lazy, the guy who did this. He hasn't created all 511 examples yet, but he's working on that. But the cool thing about it, you can actually take these and then just copy and paste directly into PowerShell. So this will teach you how to get started with PowerShell in R2 in here. Can we switch back? So for some of the other changes are actually very cool, and they relate to all of us. Content management. How many of you worked with SMS when it was called SMS 1.2 and 2.0? A good few of you. Means that you're as old as I am. Happy to see that you're still around. Do you remember the we had called stopjob.executable? Yeah, you do. So stop job executable was like a panic button. It's like, what have I done? I've seen a few examples where some administrators, they went in, created the package, and then the package source was the entire C drive. And then trying to distribute that. And it basically breaks everything, right? First of all, it cannot even create the package source. Second, when you start to deploy that to 150 distribution points and you have a very poor bandwidth connection, it's going to be a very long weekend. So stop job is not reintroduced in here as a utility, but we do have the power to do the same in the console. So when you go into your monitoring node now, and if you start a distribution, you can actually go in there, right-click the distribution, and say cancel. You can also go in and redistribute. So the control in there is absolutely better. Other things we do have is the pull distribution points. The pull distribution points were introduced in Service Pack 1. I've used them quite a bit in scenarios where I want to offload the distribution point. Because if you have 80 distribution points, it's the primary site server that is responsible for processing all of those distributions. So the distribution point manager is pretty busy. with a pull distribution point, you can go in and then you can say, well, I want to pull content from this master, or I want to pull content from this master. And then it's suddenly the master that is doing all of the processing. So the pull DP has been improved in the way that they now send up status messages just like a normal distribution point. And they can also go in and prioritize their masters. So you can actually say, well, I have these three masters, and they all have priority one. Then we'll just go in and randomly select one, or you can go in and say this has priority two, so it will only be selected if one of the other ones are actually down. and then we also report. And can I go back to my demo again? Thank you. So let's just close this one down here. So if I go to my administration node and select my servers and site systems, then I have a few distribution points. So I have my CMO2. And if I look at this one, then you will notice that this is a pull distribution point. So when it's a pull distribution point, it has to have a master. Okay, this master here is running HTTP. My CMO2 is running HTTPS, so that is not an issue. And I can go in and configure multiple masters if I want to. Like that. So now this pull DP has two masters. They both have the same ranking. Ranking was one, so it will just randomly select one of them. And if I go in and distribute some content, and I can do that still using PowerShell here. So here you can see with a single line, just start CM content distribution, I can go in and say, please go ahead and distribute my my toolkit package and then distribute it to a CMO2. So what the distribution manager will do in the background now, there is no configuration manager sessions without a log file. So here we have the distribution points of the distribution manager. It will actually notice my pull distribution point and say, hey, you need to wake up. There is actually some content for you. So my pull distribution point will now go ahead and use bits to download the content from its master. So it's not using SMB like we normally do when we distribute content to a distribution point. It's actually using the exact same protocol as your branch distribution points were using in CMO7. I can see all of this going on in my on my CMO2 server. So if I go into my CMO2, then in here, I have, since it is a distribution point, I have the content library, I have the SMS folder, I have the SMS underscore DP dollar folder in where I will find my extract content and some of the other utilities. And then I also have the client. And since this is actually a pull distribution point, then my pull DP log file, which is the one I want to use if I want to troubleshoot, is actually found in the client. So you can see right now that it started to process the content, or it should at least be starting to process the content and just be able to service my clients like any other DP. Any in here using pull distribution points today? Nope. Any of you were using branch distribution point in CMO7? Yeah, you were. Are you still on CMO7? Yeah, okay, so you're one of the features, I didn't mention that, but that is actually when you migrate those, you can actually migrate them directly into a pull distribution point. So the migration wizard has changed a little bit in R2 as well. It's not a big issue in Service Pack 1 because just migrate the distribution point and then you can go into the properties afterwards. But it just makes things a little bit easier. Improvements that we can actually not see, but you will experience if you have multiple distribution points. That is, when you send out content, in CM12 Service Pack 1 and in RTM, we don't really control who gets the content first. So if you have 50 distribution points, we're just like, please don't let it go to Kazakhstan first, because that's going to kill all the other deployments. Now what we will do in the background is we will actually calculate how fast the content goes to each of the distribution points. And then it will use that internally as a ranking the next time it does a deployment. We cannot control that. We can't even really see it. I can't. I have tried looking in WMI and other places, and I can't see anything. But it will recalculate every single time. So the way I control that in Service Pack 1 is actually by creating multiple distribution point groups. So I have a group with fast connected DPs, and a group with medium connected DPs, and a group with DPs I wish I didn't have. And then I connect or distribute to them at the very end. The monitoring node, if I my content status, then I should have the Configuration Manager client package. And as you can see here, I have two success and I have one failed. I can go in and view my status. And then on the fail one, I can actually go in and say, I want to see some more details. Then I would get some more details about what are the possible reasons this one failed. But I can also redistribute the package. So that's kind of nice, because we are usually looking at the distribution failures in here, and then we have to go in and find the DP, right-click the DP, and redistribute the package. Now we can just do it from directly in here. Another thing, if I go in here and play the role of a junior admin, it never ever happened to any of you in the room, but it does happen for me sometimes that we do an oops. So I'm creating a new package. My source folder in here would be SCCM sources $. And SCCM sources $ is like the root of where I have all my files, drivers, everything. So it's actually, I need this machine here for later, so that might be a bad idea. Let's just go in and select software instead. That way we'll still create an oops experience, but I can kind of control that if it should fail. Not that it will fail, of course. So I'm just going to run 123.executable. I really don't care about the program in here, because the only thing I want to do is I want to take my oops package, and then I want to distribute the content. And send it to my distribution point. So currently I do not know how many gigabytes in here. And it's absolutely a mistake, because it's my entire software repository. So what I can do is go to my monitoring node. Select my oops package. And then in here you can see it's in progress. It will probably be that for a few minutes. And then down here, now I can actually go ahead and cancel that deployment here. So it will stop the distribution, just like your stop job executable did earlier on. So this is a little feature, but it's really, really nice if you need it, because when you do this, probably Friday afternoon, and you want to go home, and you go like, whoops. And then you can switch. I have the guy on the table here just trying to switch. The final thing is the distribution point usage summary report. So we, did you switch? You shouldn't. So yeah. Okay, cool. Okay, cool. Now when you install a distribution point, it will also install a new scheduled task. That scheduled task will run daily. It will gather information from your IRS log files about how many downloads have you had, bytes, and stuff like that. And it will send up the information to SQL, and the result of the outcome is a distribution point summary report where you can actually go in and see, okay, how is this distribution point being utilized? That's pretty nice feature, and it's a feature that I've wanted for a long time, because we have scenarios where we have distribution points sitting in our DMC, and seriously, we do not believe that they're actually being used, and if they're not being used, there's no reason for us to have three distribution points in there. So with that feature, I'll be able to make some more wise decisions. Were you able to switch it back to me, please? Yeah. So the report in here, it's fairly basic. I just select my distribution point, and you will get some status about the number of bytes and so on and so forth. And you can see here how many requests I've been processing. And there's really nothing for me to set up except that don't disable IRS locking, because that is how they get the information. So we need to have that enabled. Now you can switch back again. So with that, some considerations about doing the migration. The migration is supported from Service Pack 1. That was why I asked the question, how many of you are still running RTM? And most of you are running Service Pack 1. When you do the upgrade, you need to uninstall your ADK first. Because there is a new ADK, and those of you who just attended Nihao's session, he spoke about that. And for you, sir, who are running a multiple primary sites, the message you're seeing up here was a message we saw when we did an upgrade to Service Pack 1, and if not all sites were upgraded, we had issues with the replication, and it will just say, hey, basically can't create this object because it's not supported on the other machine. Now you will be allowed to create the objects, but since they're not supported on the other primary site because it's not upgraded yet, it will just not replicate, but you'll still be able to upgrade it. With that, I'll give it over to you, Michael.
Okay, so let's talk quickly about what's changed in OSD. And the biggest things obviously are going to be support for the new OS. So Config Manager 2012 R2 adds support for Windows Server 2012 R2. And Windows 8.1. It's also added a new ability around managing VHD. So basically you can use Config Manager to create a task sequence and then to automate the creation of a VHD. So Config Manager would actually use PowerShell and Hyper-V to create a VM, to create media, to put that media into the VM, attach it to the VM, start the VM up, let it run through the whole task sequence, and then shut it down and store that as a VHD file. You could then take it the next step and actually take that VHD file and push it to VMM. So it's really designed to help with these VMM, VHD, virtual machine template management challenges. At the same time, there's also a few of the actions from MDT that have been moved into Config Manager. We can take a look at those. So you're seeing over time that the functionality that's in MDT for Config Manager will migrate into Config Manager. Now that won't happen overnight. Up to three of the task sequence actions so far, they'll have to do the rest of them in subsequent releases depending on how many resources they can actually come up with. So there is a new version of ADK required. You have to use the ADK for Windows 8.1. That will support deploying Windows 7, Windows 8, and Windows 8.1. If you're wanting to deploy older OSs like Windows XP and Windows Vista, you can still do that. You would just need to use a Windows PE 3.1 boot image to do that. As far as Windows 8.1 goes, it deploys just like Windows 8. In fact, you won't see any differences in the task sequences regarding that. There is support for OSD site system roles in R2 so that you can put your state migration points, distribution points, and similar things on your R2 servers as well. The VHD logic, which we'll walk through in a bit, is to create the VHD, which is text-based, and then also to update those VHDs to apply patches to them. So you can use the same scheduled update mechanism that was added in Config Manager 2012 to update WIM images to also update VHDs. The task sequence template that was added is basically just a standard task sequence, but stripped down to only include the steps necessary to create a VHD. So it doesn't include things like driver injection. It doesn't include a lot of the bulk of the standard task sequence. When we look at that one, we'll see that it's fairly small. So fairly easy to set up. Once that is created, it runs through the wizard. The wizard does all of the work, and we'll take a look at that in a second in the demo. The native MDT actions that have been moved into Config Manager, there's three of them. One is to check the readiness of a computer, so make sure it has enough disk space, enough CPU, enough memory, and also has a check in it that says, is this task sequence intended for a client OS or a server OS? So if you have an accident-prone Config Manager administrator that accidentally sends Windows 8.1 to be a task sequence to all of your Windows domain controllers, that check would see, oh, this is a client task sequence. It's running on a server OS, abort. So simple action there. There's another one called set dynamic variables, which is kind of a subset of the MDT gather process. So if you're used to the gather process and custom settings.ini, this is kind of a GUI version of that. It doesn't have all the functionality of MDT. It doesn't have the ability to talk to SQL or web services or anything like that. But if you just want to build simple if-then type rules, you can do that using this action. And then the third one is to run PowerShell scripts as part of a task sequence. The task sequence can, you can add this into the task sequence, specify a package containing your PowerShell script, specify the name of the script, and it'll take care of doing the rest. So let's switch over to this machine, and let's do a quick walkthrough of all of those. Hopefully you can see this okay. First, for the task side, when I right-click, I can choose to create a task sequence. And the new option is to install an existing image package to a virtual hard drive, where I can choose a boot image, and then the image that I want to use for this. So I'll choose Windows 8.1. I don't really need a product key since I'm using Enterprise. I prefer to be able to actually log into this thing, so it's best to have a password on the administrator account. We can leave it in a workgroup if we want, because we're just building basically a template. We need to specify the Config Manager client, because that'll be installed as part of the task sequence. We could install any optional applications that we want, and that's really it. So the task sequence that we end up with is fairly short. So let's edit that one just to see what it created there. It basically boots into PE, partitions the disk, applies the OS, puts some settings into the unattend.xml, applies any device drivers that might be needed, which typically would be none, installs the Config Manager client after the OS is up and running, and finally shuts down the computer. Now, the shutdown is basically the signal then that this automated update process is done. So after it's run through all the steps and the computer shuts down, the Config Manager wakes up and says, oh, okay, I'll now turn this into a VHD file. So the next step then would be to say I want to create a virtual hard drive, tell it where I want to put that VHD file, and then I choose the tech I want to run. So I could use that tech ed one that I just created. get a little impatient, it didn't finish populating the list of packages. You can choose a distribution point to pull content from, because it's basically going to create standalone media from that entire content. And at that point, it's set to go. So now in the background, this is going to apply the image that I selected into a temporary folder. It's going to put the packages and the boot images and everything else into that same folder. It's going to bundle that up as a VHD. It's then going to attach that VHD to a VM, create a VM in Hyper-V, turn on that VM in Hyper-V, let the task sequence run to completion, wait for the system to shut down, and then store the resulting VHD into the location that I specified. So that would take probably about an hour and a half to let that whole process go through. Now, we probably don't want to sit here for an hour and a half watching a progress dialog go by, so we can ignore that for now. But if we do look in Hyper-V, we can't yet see the VM, but we can come back and check on it later to see the VM getting started up, because right now it's still creating media. So it'll create that temporary VM, it'll do its work, it'll then delete the VM and store the VHD. So I ran through that process earlier today where I created a VHD, in this case named it's in the location that I told it to put it. From here, I could use the scheduled updates capability to patch it, or I could run a wizard to upload it to Virtual Machine Manager. So that's basically the new VHD capabilities. It's really just designed to make VHD creation easy and also to help with the management of it by applying patches and also to push that into VNL. The next piece then is for the new task sequence actions. So I have a separate task sequence which I want to look at from a different machine. I have a task sequence here that actually contains all three of those new steps. So we can edit it. So you can see the new steps are in the menu. So under General, there's one to run PowerShell script, one to set dynamic variables, and one to check readiness. So I've added those three into the PowerShell, or into the task sequence. So the first is to run a PowerShell script. So I've chosen a package and a script from that package. If we look at the contents of that package, I have a very simple PowerShell script that just says hello world and then creates a task sequence environment and dumps out all the variable values, so nothing too there. The step then just has a few simple dynamic rules, so you can add a rule based on the computer, so based on the MAC address or asset tag, UUID or serial number. Then I want to set either an existing environment variable or task sequence variable, where it'll show me the list of all the built-in ones, or I can set my own custom variable where I can just type in the name. So that's basically the structure that you're setting up. You can create as many of these if-then rules as you want to set as many variables as you want. So I've got a couple of samples here that say, if this is the MAC address, then set OSD network join type equal to 0. So if this computer, then don't join a domain. Or if this is a Microsoft virtual machine, then set a custom variable named MyVM to yes. So what you would do with this is kind of a blank slate. You can use it to set whatever task sequence variables you want based on other task sequence variables, based on information obtained from WMI. So really just designed to make your task sequence more dynamic, and you would then use the results of this to control the flow of subsequent steps. The last step then is the readiness check. This check allows you to specify the minimum amount of memory, the minimum processor speed, minimum free disk space before this task sequence would run, or to specify that the current OS to be refreshed is either a client or a server. So if I set that to client and it runs on a server, it'll generate an error. If I set it to server and it runs on the client, it'll generate an error. So that's my task sequence. I've then deployed that out to all the systems so that I can execute it real quick. We go into Software Center. There's my task sequence. I can specify to run it. Since I've run it before, it says retry, but
This is one of those task sequences that's fairly safe to run on a site server because it doesn't really do anything except run that PowerShell script and set a few variables. And it failed at the end because this is a server OS. I told it this should be run on a client OS, so that's the type of failure that you would see as a result of that. If we look in the logs, we can see what actually happened in that task sequence. Since this is a site server, the task sequence log is in the SMSCCN folder. There's our log file. Let's scroll up to the top. We can see that it dumps out all the task sequence variables, so all these task sequence variables already existed in the environment. So if you're curious what variables are set, we can see it processing the rules, looking at the MAC address of the machine. It evaluated to true, so it then set a variable based on the results. So basically you can follow the logic that it used for that. And then here was the failure. So it knew that it was specified to run on a client OS, but it found that it was running on server OS, so as a result, it forced a failure. So that is pretty much it for OSD. Those are the new capabilities. Let's switch back over to the PowerPoint deck.
I think we will actually skip the PowerPoints for the rest of the session here. So just a few questions, because I'm not bringing all of that back to Denmark. Trust me, I had actually to pay extra to bring it to New Zealand. So why do you want to continue integrating MDT? And I'm not saying you shouldn't, but what would be some valid reasons for continuing to integrate MDT with Configuration Manager? The UDI wizard, yep. Peter, you want to do the honors? Here you go. Any other? There got to be plenty of reasons. I can think of a few other reasons.
Get access to more scripts and stuff that you can't do already.
Sorry, you can. Absolutely. That was exactly what Michael said, that this is like the first integration we see, but there are lots of other scripts and variables and stuff like that we do not have right now. And yeah, absolutely. So Peter, do you want to run again? Because you're doing such a good job. No? I have one for you up here. So cool. So can we switch to number one, please? So some of the changes we have relies to the software update feature. And if I go to my device collections, I have a folder here containing my software update collections. And in here, for instance, my workstation production machines, and if I go into the properties, you'll see that I can now create a new maintenance window, actually controlling my software updates. Let me just call it someone, applies to, and then it will only apply to my software updates. So now maintenance windows for your updates, you have maintenance windows for your other deployments, and for task sequences, we have had those for quite a while. And you'll be able to see these changes here in the client. So if you go on to the client, take a look at the service manager log file, you'll be able to see it in there when it applies. You can also go into WMI on the client and verify that you actually do have the right service window. And you can also go into SQL, of course. Cannot change anything in SQL, but you'll still be able to go in here and see that I actually created a new service window, the one that I called SUM1. And if I look at the type here, you'll see that the software update point service window is type 4. That can be very useful when you're troubleshooting that, because that type will also be written to the log file. So if you want to troubleshoot whether or not the maintenance window were applied, just look for that type. Another feature when it comes to our software updates, let me go down to my automatic deployment rule. So how many of you are familiar with automatic deployment rules? I take it some of you are. Okay. That's a little surprising because half of the room were using CM12, but only like 10 people are familiar with automatic deployment rules. So the deployment rule is helping us create downloading, for instance, our patch Tuesday deployments. So what I'll do in here is just quickly go through, because this is not new, create a deployment for my pilot environment. And I always create a new software update group and I never enable it because I'm a chicken. I want to be around when it's patch Wednesday morning. Oops, I already have a rule with that name. Another neat little thing is the detail level. Those of you who are familiar with CM07, you know when you run a software update deployment, you get a lot of information back, like reboot pending, currently downloading, and all of that stuff. In order to get the same information in here, you need to enable all messages. Otherwise, by default, you will only get the error messages back in your reports. And this is the new stuff. So in here, I can go in and say, well, I want to select my product, and then select whatever product I want to go down to some windows. Here you go, Windows 7, 8, 8, 1. Okay, and now the question is, how many updates am I actually going to download? How will you figure that out in Service Pack 1, those of you who are running with Service Pack 1 and have been running with automatic deployment rules? There's one answer: going through the process and then look and realize that you just downloaded like 25 gigabytes and you sent that out to all your distribution points. That's not the correct answer. In Service Pack 1, you would actually have to go into the rule engine log file, and when you start the process, you can see there, hey, I'm going to download 250 updates. And downloading 250 updates, that's wrong. Seriously, that you shouldn't download that many. Now, they have placed that into the wizard in here, so when I click the preview button, it's actually going to do that filtering and tell me, okay, I'm going to download this many updates. So that's kind of nicer, and I can see here 182. That's definitely wrong. So there must be some stuff in my filter here that I need to go in and remake. So that's one change, the preview. Let me just change that one here. Then another change is in your existing automatic deployment rule. If I go in and open up the properties here, you'll see that I can now select a new deployment package. And that has been one of the headaches for me, especially because I had to use a PowerShell script in Service Pack 1 to go in and change the package. And I don't want to have just one large package for all my updates. I might want to split them up per month, depending on the bandwidth that I have. Or I might want to split them up per quarter, stuff like that. But I don't want to use one big package for all of my updates. So right now, we can just go ahead and make the change in here. And how are we doing on the Mac stuff? We're okay. Are you mic'd up, Peter?
Yep.
Okay, so what Peter is going to demonstrate you now is how we can enroll Mac OS X devices in R2. That changed quite a bit since Service Pack 1. So now we can actually do it without going into long command lines.
Exactly. So I already opened the package, which you can download from the internet website from Microsoft. And let's double click this package. So you see there's a graphical interface to install the client. Let's run through this.
While this one is running, how many of you actually installed Mac OS clients in Service Pack 1? A few. Was that a easy process? No, not at all.
Did you automate?
No. So just for those of you who have not tried it, in Service Pack 1, it's actually a command line. You have to go in and then reboot and then another command line. So it wasn't actually that easy. But now we have a GUI.
Yep, we have a GUI. I just rebooted the Mac device. So what we should be able to see right now, after rebooting, is a graphical interface to enroll the client into Config Manager. And there it is. So let's quickly zoom in. So what we need to do is just authenticate to Config Manager and AD. And it's going to enroll my machine into Config Manager. It's all done. How easy it was that? So what we next should do is quickly go into the preferences. We see that there is Config Manager client, which we are able to connect to the Config Manager environment. So if we remotely connect to our Windows server with Config Manager R2.
So now you're managing Config Manager from a Mac?
Yep. So in a minute we should be able in your session.
Damn.
And here's my just enrolled device. So from now on you're able to deploy settings, deploy applications.
Pretty cool. Thanks, Peter. Yeah. So, for those of you who are not familiar with the Mac OS management, it requires that we do have HTTPS. You don't have to have HTTPS running on all your site systems, but you have to have it on your enrollment point, on at least one distribution point, one management point as well. and it can basically just be a virtual box. Can I just have you switch back to the slide, please? So this is the what's new in MDM. This is the teaser that I had earlier when I started the presentation. Peter and James, they will do an R2 device session tomorrow about how you enroll iOS devices and RT devices and so on. You're also enrolling RT devices, right? Yeah, they're nodding. So they definitely do that. One more change that I would like to mention in R2 in the on-premise stuff is that we now have role-based administration also for our reporting. And those of you who have been working with role-based administration, you might have seen that even though you're a software deployment author and you only have access to all workstations, then you can actually still go in and select all collections. That has now been changed. There's really nothing you have to do. It's just part of the normal role-based administration. With that, we are like 2 minutes over time, but since we started 3 minutes later, that leaves us with still 1 minute or 2 minutes. It's actually just lunch after this, so I'm in no hurry here. So questions, Q&A, yeah? So you need to update. Yeah, you need to update the ADK before. Yeah.
But does the install of R2 check if ADK has been updated?
It actually.
It actually
performs a check. I'm pretty sure it does that because I forgot it the first time. That's the. Peter, can you assist me because I need to get rid of some of all this.